me see. So I'm going to intro a first speaker. His name is Chris Carter. He is the EIR, and that is the Entrepreneur in Residence. That's a fancy, that's a nice title. At Schulich. I didn't finish school, so. And York University, board chair. He's a whole bunch of stuff. So guys, let's give a warm welcome to Chris Carter.
Okay, well, I'm so excited to be here tonight. I've had this story in me for a long time, and I've been waiting to tell it. First of all, I'm going to give you a little flashback. This is me in 1997, and at the time, I was the board chair for the White Ribbon Campaign and Violence Against Women and Children, men working on that. And this is me after I walked a mile in women's high heel shoes. And I can tell you that a fuck-up for a man is a lot like walking a mile in high heel shoes when you finally get to take them off and it's over. And tonight I'm gonna tell you one of those great fuck ups. But when it was done, this is how I felt. This fuck up starts when I had my first company, ThinData, which was originally a web development company, over time became the largest email marketing company in Canada. And at the time, everything was golden. Everything was working beautifully. We were growing, we were happy, we were a family. Everything was good. And one day, this fine gentleman came into town. And we thought we were going so well, we could turn anything into a business that we put our hands on. So we met this guy, Roger Clemens. He had just signed on with the Toronto Blue Jays as their new ace pitcher. And we had this idea, we would make websites for athletes on the side of what we were doing, and we would help them to sell merchandise that they had autographed through the website. And Roger's website, which you can see a little bit, the header of down here, was rocketroger.com. And he would go on the site, and he would talk to the fans, and he would report on the games. Now, we knew a little thing that we noticed about Roger is that when he would win, he would go on that night and talk all about the game. When he would lose, it might take him about 7 or 8 days before he would talk about the game afterwards. But he was a good guy. We liked working with him. It was really off to a great start. We also got Trish Stratus, who was with the WWE. We got Cujo when he was with the Leafs as the goalie. And we got Jerome Williams with the Toronto Raptors. So we were off to a great start. Things started to get a little weird really quickly with Roger and with a couple things that we noticed about him in terms of how he worked with us. The first thing I noticed was that this was, at the time, this was the richest man who I had ever, hung out with in my life. I think he was making $20 million a year in his contract, give or take a dollar here or there back then. And I would sit in rooms with him and he would get paid $20,000 to sign baseballs for an hour. So he had more money than I had ever seen in my life. But when we would go downstairs to the convenience store, he would walk around the convenience store. He would get the milk that he wanted. He would get the chips that he wanted. He would get the chocolate bars that he wanted. He would put them all on the shelf, and then he would step back, and he would wait for me to pay. Now, at the time, I don't think I could barely pay like my rent, my mortgage, whatever I had, pay my food bill, whatever it was. But this was my first little thing that I thought, this is going to be an interesting person to work with. And he was very nice to work with sometimes, but this was the first little thing that set me off. The second thing that set me off was that I got the opportunity. He asked my partner and I, Chancellor is my partner, our CTO, he asked if he could fly us down to his house. This is his house in Houston. It's beautiful. It has an indoor basketball court where he likes to invite the Houston Rockets over to come and play a little pickup. And it has his own go-kart track for his kids. They all have a car. And there was an elevator in the house to take everybody upstairs to the cinema up at the top of the house. So the next thing that I noticed about working with Roger was he was very kind and generous about taking us down there, but was a story that his dog here went missing one day, and they didn't know where the dog was, and the family sent the staff into the sewer system on their hands and knees to look for the dog. So at that point, I started getting a little bit concerned about what might happen if I was ever lost and what Roger would do to me. Now, this was all building up. Everything was great. We went down. We, set up his ISDN line. We bought his computer equipment for him. And we taught his kids how to use the internet. It was a great little trip, and me and Chancellor had a good time. But soon after that, a terrible thing happened. For the people of Toronto and for ThinData, my company, Roger was traded to the New York Yankees. He was actually very smart as to how he did it. He went into the middle of the Blue Jays locker room, and he said that he had demanded a trade, and it was on rocketroger.com, which made the website go crazy, and he would not be commenting on it except what he had wrote on the website, which was maybe one of the first athletes to really like stand up and take control of their message. He was smart, he was great to work with, but he's a little bit quirky. So here he was off to the Yankees, and we thought, wow, what a great opportunity. Now we're working with a New York Yankee. Now this company is gonna go to the moon, everything's gonna be fantastic. Except that Roger didn't return our texts or our phone calls when he went to New York, and we couldn't get in touch with him, and he disappeared because he was now in New York. And we were so starstruck and smitten with him when we first met him that we hadn't signed any kind of like official contract that said what would happen if he got traded or if he disappeared or what would happen. Now, I was a little bit nervous right around this time as well, because with the company, we had raised from two angels, angel investors, and you know, a lot of us who are starting companies are running around town finding angels to fund our companies. We'd raised $20,000 from two gentlemen who were well-known businessmen in the local community. And I was a little bit worried about what happens if this company, which was this side company, what happens if things don't work out? Well, we couldn't find Roger, we couldn't get Roger, the site wasn't being updated, and he was happy, he was in New York, he was a Yankee, he was a star, he was pitching the lights out and doing amazing things. So we called the agent down in Texas, and we talked to the agent, and we explained the situation, because we figured, I think maybe it's like when a girlfriend or a boyfriend disappears, and like you think maybe they just switched their phone or something like that, but really, like actually, they burn their phone and they don't want you to know what it is. So we called the agent. It's like calling, you know, the girlfriend's mom or something like that. So we called the agent to say, like, you know, what happened with Roger? Because does he have a new phone or something like that? Why isn't he calling us back? And so the agent said, well, he said, Roger is a New York Yankee now. And there was silence. And I tried to figure out what, yes. And I told the story again, but yes, we have this project and we're working with him and we need his help and we need him to work on everything. And the agent said, young man, Roger is no longer in Toronto. And he hung up the phone. So at that point in time, we were in big trouble, okay? Does anyone know what this line is? Does anyone know what it represents? This is the dot-com collapse. So within like 18 months after Roger disappeared, the dot-com collapse came. The Repo Man, he's a character from wrestling. The Repo Man was at the door. He was like taking the shredded box from us. The HST guy showed up at our doorstep looking to take our computers. My dad actually got served with papers by the CIBC while walking the dog by my house because the CIBC was angry at me over some line of credit that I hadn't paid off or something like this. These were dark, terrible, horrible times. But on top of all that, there were these three gentlemen. And the gentleman on the left is the first person who I got part of the $20,000 from. And the person on the top is the second person. Derek Rushton, the chairman of Enveronics, big national polling company. Michael Adams, the pollster. And they had given me $20,000. Now, these days in the startup community, and back then as well too, if you take money from an angel and it's equity and the business fails, what happens? You just move on, right? Everybody screws up. Everybody just moves on. Everybody like builds another company. We all learn. People lose their money, and that's just what happens when angels invest. But this third gentleman, Barry Watson, who was the individual who had introduced me to the first two, he took me aside and he said, I think it would be very wise if you were to repay Derek and Michael their money. You don't owe it to them. It's not a loan, you didn't personally guarantee it, but you should probably pay it back. So, thinking about that and thinking about the message that he gave me, over the next 3 years, Chancellor and I, my partner, repaid the $20,000, $150 at a time, $200 at a time, $300 at a time. Sometimes we'd skip a month, but we'd always come back to it. We didn't have a contract, we didn't have agreement. We didn't even talk to Derek and Michael about it. We sent up checks in an envelope to the Bloor Street office, and they cashed them. And eventually, one day, we'd paid off the $20,000. Now, right around the same time, ThinData, which was transforming now into an email marketing platform, started to take off. I'd won the Aeroplan account, I'd won the Air Canada account, we were picking up business left, right, and center, but I didn't have enough money to fuel the business. So the only person I had ever asked for money or I thought knew anything about giving it out was Derek Rushton, who I'd repaid the $20,000 to. And back then, at that point in time, to make myself like sound like digital grandpa here in Toronto, back at that point in time, there's no accelerators, and the VCs are nowhere to be found, and the angel networks are hiding somewhere, and I don't know where the heck the money was, but it wasn't anywhere where you could find it. So I went to Derek just to ask him, how do you get $1 million when you need $1 million? And what do you think that that Derek said? Sitting at lunch with me asking him that question, he said, you ask me for it. And I said, what do you mean I ask you for it? He said, ask me for $1 million. I said, Derek, could I please have $1 million for my company? And he said, yes. I will be back in 90 days. I'm gonna go talk to my friends and I'll get you $1 million. We met again in 90 days. We sat down at the lunch table and he put a check across the table. We'd signed a bunch of paperwork earlier the day before, but he put the check across the table. It was for $1.2 million. And he said, Chris, I learned everything I needed to know about you the day you repaid my $20,000. Okay? Four years later, Chancellor and I sold that company with Derek as our like fundamental shareholder and investor. We sold that company after having been on the edge of annihilation personally and professionally in bankruptcy and thinking we're gonna lose our homes and everything that we had. We sold the company for $18 million cash to a public company called Transcontinental. So this is a message I really wanted to share tonight with everybody because, you know, you do have fuck-ups and you do have mistakes, and sometimes it's not just like a mistake inside a company. Sometimes the whole company is a fuck-up. Sometimes the whole company goes haywire, you know? And I don't think Roger ever meant to hurt us. I don't think he ever meant any harm. I think he just got wrapped up in being in New York. Who wouldn't? He moved off and he was in New York and there were the lights and it was shiny and it wasn't Toronto. But when that thing fell apart, the fact that we repaid that money was the karmic event that then led to the success for ThinData. So what I would like you to think about tonight is if you are a startup company that's taking money from people, that it's not play money that's getting thrown around. This is money that people have worked hard to earn and have worked hard to, you know, acquire so that they could share it with people to do great things. And your company might fail, your company might be a fuck up, and you might not be able to pay it back, but please, whoever has trusted in you like that and given you that money, find a way, whether it's writing a check, whether it's bringing them a client, whether it's bringing them lunch, whether it's washing their car, whatever it is, find a way, something that you can do to repay that money, not only for them, but for yourself, and because what it means to your reputation and what can it mean to your next business. Thank you.
Wow, Chris, that was great. That wasn't that an inspiring story? That because he paid back, he paid back that $20,000 a little bit at a time, it turned into 18 million. So the lesson here is big little steps. So all those little things that you think that you're doing that don't mean anything, they actually do mean something in the end. So just take those little steps and eventually it'll be a big thing. So listen, I fucked up earlier. I forgot to give his fun facts, so here they are. He walked a mile in women's high heels for charity. He also once co-created Canada's only national radio show on professional wrestling and once had Rowdy Piper in the office. Wow. And he sings regularly as a member of choir. So does anyone, this is the Q&A part, does anyone have any questions that they want to ask Chris?
If anyone asks me to sing, I'm not doing that
tonight. Oh, yes. Can you do the Roddy Roddy Piper thing? Like the, no? Okay. Are you guys... don't know who Roddy Roddy Piper is? No? Okay, wow, we're old. Anyone have any questions? There we go, there's a question right there.
So the situation with the baseball player, have you ever handled a situation similarly and had a completely different outcome?
I've never had anyone who I took care of and repaid in that way, or made sure that I was, like, you know, straightforward with money, not repay it. But I do have, like, there was another time that was really important in the company's history that was very similar and maybe a smaller example of what people could do. We had a client, a big national hotel corporation, and we had, like, a big mistake, that a big fuck-up that happened. Let's get the language right. It's not a mistake. It's a fuck-up. A big fuck-up that happened with a campaign that we did. And what happened was that the algorithm in the campaign and the contest engine gave out $20,000 worth of prizes in the first 3 seconds of the campaign. Yeah! That was awesome. I have an issue with $20,000, I think. So... one of my vice presidents, his name's Wayne Kerrigan, he's this really cool entrepreneur executive out in Vancouver now. He comes into my office and he says, there's been a situation and I need you to take out your checkbook. So that, I don't like that as soon as that's the starting of a conversation. So he explained what happened and I said, okay, well, what are you gonna do? He said, well, I'm going to go and I'm going to sit in the lobby. I'm getting in a taxi right now. You're gonna write the check for 20 grand. I'm gonna go and sit in the lobby of this hotel corporation, and I'm going to wait till the executive vice president of marketing walks through the lobby during the day, and I will ask him for 5 minutes. When he says yes, I will go sit at his desk, I will put the check across the table in his hands, and then I will explain what happened, right? So he did that, and he said basically, well, the good news is you get to make another, like, you know, 50 people really happy with $20,000 more prizes. And we wrote the check, and we had the company, the vice president came and took me out to lunch like a month later and signed a 2-year contract for $2 million. So with every opportunity for every fuck up if you have in the business or when you're working with a client, like really what the client cares about is how you own it and how you take care of it. And there's been a few over the years. I've been doing businesses now for almost 25 years. Before I came here tonight, I sent a last email to a bunch of my former executives and asked them if there were any glorious fuck-ups that I should be reminded of before I came here tonight. And they told me a couple of them, and I swear to God they hid them, right? Because I was like, when the hell did that happen, right? Where was I? Was I on vacation? Did I just get married? Like, what happened? When? Anyways, well, I'm not going to tell that one. That one was like... way overboard, but every time you can find a way to deal with it. The most creative one that I ever did was very, very early on. We had a similar situation where something went wrong for 48 hours with a website we had built for the YMCA, and we wrote the check, we paid them, but I gave my staff, and this was the decision I would slightly do over again. I gave the staff who were responsible for the fuck up, two choices. One was, it was the fuck up that was worth about 12 grand. I told them that they could take the fuck up, I'd take the fuck up out of their paychecks over the next half year, or they could go run in the weekend's YMCA marathon, 10K, I don't know, marathon, 10K, something, 5K, something bad that they had to go do as a result. And I went to the finish line, and they decided to run because they didn't want to pay the 12K. So I went to the finish line, and I gave them all a hug. The only thing I regret about that afterwards that I should have done is that I put all the responsibility on them, and based on how I view things now and how I try to lead my teams, I would have gone in the run myself and not be a chicken and wait for them at the finish line, right? I might die, but... I would at least try to do the run.
That was a great question. Anyone else? Any more questions? So basically, be a good person. Don't be shitty. That's really what it is. Thank you so much,
Chris. Thank you,
everybody. Thank you. Round of applause for Chris.